Throughout history, women have been celebrated as carers of the wounded, as well as being executed for sleeping with the enemy. This program explores the history of women at war behind the scenes, in their traditional role of tending the sick and injured, but also as agents in wartime espionage, the spies and angels. The idea of women being part of an army is not a modern one. In the Middle Ages, they helped to form what was almost an additional force to the main body of an army. They were called camp followers.
Well, camp followers were very common in the Middle Ages. You had women who were, in a sense, support troops, playing a variety of roles, but of course many of those roles are roles nobody wanted to talk about, like the camp follower. So wherever an army went, and armies in the Middle Ages were quite small by modern comparison, modern standards, you had this movement of people along with them that included many women.
So by following the army, tending to the wounds of the soldiers, and often providing for virtually all their needs, women were becoming an integral part of the war machine. And women weren't becoming involved in conflicts just as amateur medics. By the time of the English Civil War in 1642, there were already accounts of women acting as spies.
In general, women spies operate as scouts, as informants, as couriers. There are a few examples of anonymous women who just show up in the records doing things like serving as an informant once and being paid a small fee. There's also examples of women who serve as a scout over and over again.
Women on the battlefield were useful in the baggage train, though to be part of one was not considered entirely respectable. Nursing, too, was something of a euphemism, not at all a job for a lady. But the popular perception of the nurse was about to be changed by one woman, Florence Nightingale, who learned her skills at a small hospital for sick gentlemen in London's Harley Street. She was asked by Sidney Herbert, the Minister for War, to lead a party of 38 nurses and take over the running of the military hospital at Scutari in Turkey.
There were certain people in the government, particularly her sponsor, Sidney Herbert, the Minister of War, who regarded Florence Nightingale as a potential saviour of a very bad situation. Sidney Herbert was a reformer, so several of the reformers in the government saw Florence Nightingale as a means of actually bringing some positive result from an otherwise very negative situation.
An angel of mercy was just what the British government needed in its search to provide a positive image of the Crimean War. Florence Nightingale's sober outfit certainly helped cement that positive image of frontline nurses in the public mind. She looked almost like a nun, at once efficient, angelic, and untouchable. The myth of the angelic nurse was born. Florence Nightingale wrote in her diary, "It may seem a strange principle to enunciate as the very first requirement in a hospital that it should do the sick no harm. But at Scutari, she and her team of nurses put that strange principle into practice." Thanks to her endeavours, the death rate in Crimean War hospitals was reduced by 40%. Some women who ministered to the injured at the front combined their medical role with another activity, spying. The strategic position of field hospitals and the ability of nurses to move about relatively freely meant that women were ideally placed to act as scouts and provide valuable information about the enemy. 5 years after the hostilities had ceased in the Crimea, the American Civil War broke out. It was to rage from 1861 to 1865 and present women with many opportunities to combine these roles. Indeed, there are countless examples of women who took to spying with enthusiasm. Of the most colorful was Dr. Mary Walker from Oswego, New York.
When the war broke out, Dr. Walker tried vainly to receive a surgeon's commission from the federal government in the Union Army. She presented her credentials and her diploma, but was repeatedly turned down. Washington said they didn't hire women doctors. Ever persistent, Dr. Walker found a state regiment, an Ohio regiment, that really wanted a regimental surgeon, and they didn't care if the surgeon was male or female.
Walker was certainly enthusiastic. She tended to the wounded at the Battle of First Manassas in 1861, and later at the Battle of Chickamauga, Tennessee in 1863. She was captured at Virginia in 1864 and spent 4 months in prison in Richmond before she was released in a prison exchange. Dr. Walker wasted no time and went straight back to work serving at the Battle of Atlanta in September 1864. During her time as regimental surgeon, the intrepid Walker continually crossed Confederate lines to treat civilians, and it's believed that she took the opportunity while in enemy territory to act as a spy. But the opportunity for women to act as spies was not confined to those who had an active role at the front. Some came from non-military and sometimes quite exotic backgrounds. One-time actress Major Pauline Cushman, for example.
The newspapers branded her a Southern sympathizer, which of course landed her in the company of other Southern sympathizers and Southern military officials who were now inviting her to parties and attending her performances.
The resourceful Cushman made herself a favorite of Union troops and is reputed to have gathered information on troop movements and strategies, which proved very useful to Union General William Rosecrans. But on one sortie, believing that she had gathered enough useful information, Cushman headed back to Union lines, only to have her cover blown. She was captured by Braxton Bragg's troops and subjected to a drumhead court-martial.
Some stories say they were going to hang her, but their lines were overrun and she was saved at the last minute by Union troops. Whether or not her life was actually in jeopardy is subject to debate. However, she became even more famous as an actress after her return to Union lines.
The accounts of Cushman's exploits were lapped up by an excited public, all too happy to celebrate a romantic heroine who had been rescued a mere 3 days before she was due to be executed. Abraham Lincoln even awarded Cushman an honorary major's commission. No longer able to act as a spy, Pauline Cushman returned to the stage, donned her honorary uniform, and embarked on a tour with circus entrepreneur P.T. Barnum, during which she enthusiastically recounted her adventures to her audiences.
He advertised her in his circus as the spy of the Cumberland in 1864. She made a lot out of her role as a spy in the war, but I'm not sure she really did very much.
Whether Pauline Cushman's contribution was important or simply a good career move is perhaps debatable. But one thing is certain, women spies were vital to the tactics of both sides in the American Civil War. By the turn of the century, the great powers of Europe were well on their way to forming themselves into two powerful, well-armed alliances that were to bring a horrific war to the entire continent. In Britain, these events were played out against the backdrop of the burgeoning suffragette movement that aimed to secure the vote for women, a movement which was to radically accelerate the progress of women in the fields of espionage and frontline medicine. The staunch suffragette Mabel Stobart believed that one route to achieving their aims was to make themselves central to the defense of the country should war break out. Born in 1862 into a middle-class family, Stobart led a fairly unremarkable life until she was 40. But her first marriage ended in tragedy when she and her husband lost their fortune on the stock market. And after a brief and difficult spell in South Africa, Stobart's husband died in 1906.
She returned to England a widow with the need to throw herself into something else. And what she did was start the Women's Convoy Corps in 1909, which was basically an organisation of medical women set up in a military style, who were set up in order to prove that women could do their bit during war as well, to be ready if anything happened.
With the help of Lady Muir Mackenzie, Stobart subsequently oversaw the formation of the Women's National Service League. After the success of the Women's Convoy Corps, she approached the British Red Cross for support, but was told by the chairman, Sir Frederick Greaves, that there was not work fitted for women in the sphere of war. Undeterred, the formidable duo garnered support, and the WNSL led to the establishment of a hospital in Belgium, the first to be completely staffed by women.
They were overrun there by the Germans, and Mabel Stobart was held prisoner for a while and in danger of being shot as a spy. But she was released, she did get away, and as soon as she got back, she reformed her unit and went over to Serbia. And she set up a number of hospital units around Serbia. She was a commandant, and she was quite an imposing figure. She used to ride a black horse all around Serbia.
She met the King of Serbia, who she got on with very well. He made her a major in his Serbian army. And that's what she did all through the retreat, the Serbian retreat. She took her convoy of helpers all through the Montenegrin mountains, and great hardships, I think.
There were indeed great hardships. And Stobart was now 53 years old and commanding a medical convoy that was supporting an army in full retreat. She often spent 18 hours a day on horseback as they trekked through the mountains in very harsh winter conditions.
She has a wonderful little diary, which is sort of this big, and you can visualise her writing. It looks as though she's writing it on the horse because it's almost illegible, but it records everything that they do and all the experience of the retreat. She then went on lecture tours, speaking tours in Britain and indeed in America to present her ideas, having created this base so that people knew who she was.
Mabel Stobart continued to write about her experiences until her death in 1954. She is buried here in Dorset, where her family still celebrates her life, her achievements, and her steadfast belief that the more women became involved in wartime activities, the more doors would open for them elsewhere. Mabel Stobart's convoy corps pushed the boundaries of what was considered an acceptable role for the female nurse, but there were still no female doctors at the front. In fact, there weren't many female doctors at all. Elsie Inglis, however, was a qualified doctor with a fierce determination to change things. She faced stiff resistance from the British War Office at the outbreak of World War I. "My good lady, go home and sit still," she was told when she proposed sending medical units entirely staffed by women to the front lines. But the determined Inglis, a formidable Scot, was not to be so bluntly dissuaded. With the support of the National Union of Women Suffrage Societies, she formed the Scottish Women's Hospital Committee. 3 months after the outbreak of war, the first hospital unit, complete with women doctors, landed in France.
The story about the War Office saying, "My good lady, go home and sit still," is very specifically directed at Elsie Inglis. I think because the Scottish Women's Hospitals were independent and they were entirely women, they perhaps had a different kind of status to the Red Cross. Military hospitals were happy to welcome Red Cross VADs inside to do various different types of employment. But I think it was that the notion of the woman doctor was something that they couldn't really deal with. There'd never actually been women doctors before, and that was what Inglis was proposing. Her hospital units were staffed entirely with women. They didn't have any male employees, and they managed to retain that throughout the war.
In 1915, Inglis established an auxiliary hospital with 200 beds in Royalmont Abbey and sent female medical units to Serbia. In all, 14 units were sent to places as far apart as France, Corsica, Salonika, Romania, Russia and Malta. The success of the units was undeniable and support grew. The London Suffrage Society funded Inglis and 80 women to go to Russia to support troops who were fighting there. Those who had initially opposed her efforts now saw how well organized and effective her hospital units were.
I think it was the womanness of it, the femaleness of the institution, that made the War Office uncomfortable in the first instance. However, I do think that their perception of her changed during the course of the war, and it is possible to argue that she did have some influence with the War Office by about 1917, when she campaigned to get the Serbian army removed from Russia during the revolutionary period, because she was anxious about their safety. And it seems to be the case that the Serbs at least believed that she had influence with the War Office to get them moved, because they were moved.
But the role of women at the front was becoming more blurred. After all, how different was it to help heal a soldier and then help him get home to his family? Far from finding protection because of their caring roles, nurses now often found themselves placed in greater danger. No one more famously so than Nurse Edith Cavell. Edith Cavell was an ordinary middle-class woman from the city of Norwich in eastern England. In 1907, she went to Brussels to run a nurses' training school, and she remained there after war broke out in 1914.
Perhaps the story would have just remained a story of her, you know, nursing and teaching nurses in Brussels if she hadn't taken in two Allied soldiers in November of 1914. These were soldiers that had been separated from their troops and found themselves in occupied territory. She harbored those soldiers in the hospital, in the training school, and it began a career, basically, for the next few months of harboring hundreds of Allied soldiers and refugees. From the training school, there was a courier network set up, and Edith Cavell would harbor the soldiers. Couriers would pick them up and take them into neutral Holland.
Cavell was part of a network of 35 men and women who secretly helped wounded Allied soldiers return to their units. However, when two of the network were arrested, Cavell was identified from papers that they were carrying, and 5 days later, she too was arrested by the Germans. Having been allegedly tricked into confessing by her captors, she was subsequently tried and found guilty of spying. Edith Cavell was sentenced to death by firing squad, and her sentence was carried out in the early hours of October the 12th, 1915.
The Germans initially tried to use her death as a warning to others not to help Allied soldiers and not to aid the enemy in any way. The British tried to use her death for propaganda purposes and also as a recruitment tool. So many postcards and posters started appearing, showing her as a prone victim with a kind of demonic German soldier standing over her, holding a pistol to her head often. She's always portrayed as a victim, and these propaganda postcards really got the public going, not only in Britain, but interestingly enough in neutral countries like the United States and in France also. Other combatant countries. There is some evidence also that recruitment numbers went up in Britain in October and November of that year, and it's often attributed to her death and the publicity that surrounded it.
After her execution, the world's press seized upon Edith Cavell's story, and in Britain she became a martyr. But the way that her image was exploited for propaganda purposes was somewhat at odds with her own stoicism. Shortly before her execution, she wrote,
"I'm thankful for these 10 weeks of quiet to get ready. Now I have had them and have been kindly treated. I expected my sentence and believe it was just. Standing as I do, in view of God and eternity, I realize that patriotism is not enough. I must have no hatred or bitterness towards anyone."
Cavell has become ingrained in popular consciousness as a martyr. But she was not the only woman to take risks in order to help servicemen. Indeed, many women were now risking their lives to join organized groups who were involved in dangerous resistance work. One of the most successful such operations was the White Lady Network in Belgium in 1917. The White Ladies watched the train network and gathered information on troop and munitions movements. They worked as couriers within occupied territory and also across the frontier between Belgium and Holland, which was particularly dangerous at first because of the number of guards and formidable barbed wire defences. Later, the Germans put up electrified fences, but the white ladies were undeterred. They donned rubber suits to protect themselves.
The network had over 1,000 Belgian and French citizens. About a third of those were women. And it was also unusual in that they worried about the men being arrested by the German authorities or sent to forced labor camps. And so they created an entirely feminine executive as well as a shadow executive for the network. So there was a male leadership and a female leadership, and some of the battalions were commanded by women as well. So it was an opportunity really for women to serve Belgium and to feel like they were doing something in this very horrible position of being a victim otherwise.
While the work of the intrepid white ladies may have been largely forgotten, one whose name has become synonymous with the dangerous world of espionage during World War I is the Dutch dancer and prostitute Margarethe Gertruyde Zeller, better known to history by her stage name, Mata Hari. Born in the northern Dutch town of Leeuwarden, Mata Hari married a Dutch colonial officer with whom she had two children. She joined him in Java, but after a tempestuous marriage that lasted 7 years, the couple separated while on their return home. Margarethe took off for Paris. So how did this young Dutch woman acquire the iconic status of the world's most infamous female spy?
She moved to Paris and reinvented herself, which was kind of a talent of hers. She named herself Mata Hari, which supposedly translates as Eye of the Dawn. And she began dancing in what she called Javanese dancing, but it's basically erotic dancing in Paris. This was around 1905, 1907.
So did the activities of this female spy live up to the top billing she has enjoyed ever since as a femme fatale?
Mata Hari is approached in 1915 by the German Secret Service, and she does work for German intelligence, but only insofar as she gets money from them and she agrees to give them information. But she literally says she takes her bottles of secret ink and throws them into a canal and is not interested in doing anything, and she doesn't do anything. Later on, she's approached by the French counterintelligence and agrees to work for them. So in her mind, she's operating as a double agent, and she does attempt to give them whatever information she can. But in fact, the whole idea of her having hundreds of lovers and sleeping with men in order to get information out of them is really based on a kind of myth.
Many of the myths that surround Mata Hari portray her as a ruthless seductress, but history suggests that she was an unfortunate victim, the wrong woman in the wrong place at the wrong time. Today, her trial might simply be dismissed with no case to answer. But in 1917, Mata Hari was a woman caught up in a situation that she had no hope of controlling, where those she trusted would ultimately betray her.
Like many women spies who were caught, Mata Hari was actually betrayed by someone close to her. One of her German lovers betrayed her to the French authorities. And so she was actually arrested for spying for the Germans by the French, when she maintained all along that it was the French that really had her loyalty.
Major Kalle, the German military attaché, sent a message to Berlin in a code that he knew the Allies could read, saying that spy H-21 had proved valuable. The French authorities arrested Mata Hari on February the 13th, 1917. She was put on trial, found guilty of treason, and sentenced to death. On the 15th of October, 1917, Mata Hari went to her death, refusing to be tied to a stake or to wear a blindfold, and blowing kisses to the firing squad. Despite not being a terribly effective spy, Mata Hari's name has become synonymous with intrigue and sexual allure that has informed popular perceptions of the female spy. Arguably, the all-pervasive image of Mata Hari has overshadowed the real achievements of the many women spies who were operating during the First World War.
They were really responsible for tracking most of the espionage activity for the Allied armies. They also served as effective spies behind the lines in occupied territories in a variety of roles as couriers, as train watchers trying to determine how many troops and munitions were going through Belgium. And it's hard to say they were, you know, 90% effective or to give a quantitative answer. But it is significant that the British networks, for instance, in Belgium, knew the location of most of the German units by the end of the war. So they were getting information through.
But increasingly, spying wasn't the only reason that women found themselves at the front. In the 1930s, when the Spanish Civil War broke out, the artist Felicia Brown set out for the front to paint, but she was also ready to defend herself and fight for a cause she believed in. Friends of her family still remember the artist come volunteer.
She was a great friend of my grandfather's when he was at university at Cambridge in the 30s, and the drawings we have are drawings that she sent back to him from Spain at the time. She originally went to Spain to paint, but she was actually quite conscious of what was going on in the political situation, to the extent that famously she took self-defense lessons from a small recorded as being rather a diminutive Chinese gentleman in Harley Street. So she would go and do Chinese self-defense because she knew that she fully intended to get involved in the conflict. This really wasn't for the faint-hearted. This involved guns, bombs, sabotage. I think if you wanted a comparison, it'd be a bit like joining the French resistance during the Nazi occupation. One image was made before she left England to join the Spanish militia of a man in Shoreditch with a naphtha lamp, which is a kind of lamp used during power cuts and bombing in the East End of London. And the second drawing is typical of the drawings that she sent back from Spain. She made a lot of works on whatever material she could find, brown paper, bits of canvas, the back of books, sketchbooks, and posted them back to friends. And they're drawings really of typical working Spanish farmers, Spanish peasants, and also, very importantly, Spanish communists, trade union leaders, Spanish rebels, the left-wing soldiers, and people like herself who joined the militia.
Felicia was one of 2,000 or so volunteers who went to Spain from Britain. The men fought at the front, but the Republican leadership began to discourage women from doing so. They felt that the image of women fighting portrayed the wrong image for their cause. But this change of heart came too late for Felicia Brown. As one of the first volunteers to make for the front, she was involved in heavy fighting. She was shot outside the town of Zaragoza on the 25th of August 1936. She was 34.
She actually travelled with the militia to Aragon in southern Spain, where they were trying to intercept a train loaded with fascist weapons. And during the sortie, she was trying to help her colleague, a militiaman, escape from fascist fire, and she was actually shot and killed. She became a sort of figurehead of a sort of martyr to the cause, if you like, as a woman, as an artist, and also as a fighter. And became very, very well known for the fact that she was killed.
Women had certainly established their usefulness as spies in 20th century warfare. Government's policies were driven both by a realization of the value of women's contribution during wartime and, more cynically, by the necessity of finding more hands to do the work. The British government now organized female agents to fight behind enemy lines, perhaps most famously with the establishment in Britain in 1940 of the Special Operations Executive, the SOE. This mobilisation of women into a government-sanctioned organisation marked the opening of a new and radically more dangerous chapter. About a quarter of those in the SOE were female. So what did these women have to offer?
The first recruiting officer for F Section, which operated in France, was Louis Gielgud, who was the brother of the actor John Gielgud. The second recruiting officer was Selwyn Jepson, and it was his decision to recruit women to the organisation. I think that he felt that women would bring to the organisation various skills that perhaps men didn't have. For example, the fact that women were beyond suspicion. German soldiers were slow to realise that women were politicised and were involved in the resistance. So there's a number of reasons, I think, that why women were chosen.
One woman who took up the challenge that SOE presented was Oxford graduate Daphne Park, now Baroness Park of Monmouth, a woman who went on to have a high-profile career in British intelligence.
So they sent me off to the country, to a country house, as always happened then, and we scrubbed floors and we learnt to march under an unfortunate guard sergeant major. And we also were taught the rudiments of agent codes, codes used in the field by members of the resistance. And we also learnt wireless operating. And they decided that I was a better bet as a codist than a wireless operator. And I sat the exam. And so I was made an instructor. And in fact, I was a wonderful instructor because I'd made all the mistakes that the agents were ever likely to make and a few more. And I could foresee exactly what they were going to do because I did it. And I found myself, most of the time then, I was instructing individual agents, very important ones, back from the field, who sometimes were working in this part of SOE that worked with General de Gaulle, and sometimes were working in what was called the Buckmaster section, which was purely British.
Female agents were only sent into France as couriers and wireless operators, and not as arms instructors, saboteurs and organisers. Pearl Witherington is an interesting case in point because she was sent into France as a courier, but following the arrest of her organiser, Maurice Southgate, she actually assumed his masculine role as organiser and was in charge of 3,000 to 4,000 men. So it just suggests that women could undertake these roles when circumstances necessitated.
Many worked tirelessly and anonymously and with enormous bravery. Of the 53 women agents operating in France, the Germans executed 12, and 29 were either arrested or died in captivity.
One of the wonderful things about being in SOE was that you met so many brave people. Courage was the order of the day with so many of the people you dealt with, in fact, all of them.
One of these courageous women was SOE operative Odette Sansom. When she and her SOE controller and colleague Peter Churchill were captured, they claimed to be married. Odette took most of the blame for their activities and also started a rumour that Peter was related to Winston Churchill. He was treated comparatively leniently, while she suffered harshly at the hands of the Gestapo. After the war, they did actually marry.
This beautifully crafted doll was made by the SOE agent, Odette Sanson, who was parachuted into France in 1942, working for British intelligence services, trying to link up with the resistance network in France. She was captured by the Gestapo and taken to prison in France, and then transferred to Ravensbrück concentration camp in Germany, which is where she made this doll. Although the doll is beautifully made and a wonderful sort of memento of her time there, the time she spent there was actually pretty hideous. She was very badly tortured. She was left in solitary confinement with no windows for months on end, and somehow managed to keep the strength up to be able to create things like this, but also to come home and tell her story to the world afterwards.
Odette Churchill's achievements were widely recognised, but many other women never received the credit that they deserved and were simply sent back to resume their pre-war lives. Even today, their efforts remain largely unsung. World War II showed that even if women weren't allowed to fight at the front, many wanted to record events there, but were prevented by officialdom from doing so. Sometimes, however, the opportunity presented itself in unexpected ways. Doris Zinkhuizen had a successful career as a set designer and worked on many prominent productions. Having worked as a volunteer in London for the St John's Ambulance, Zinkhuizen was commissioned to paint scenes of the Red Cross at work in Belgium, France and Germany, but only at the very end of the war.
Doris Zinkhuizen was an artist who was commissioned in 1941 by the War Artists Advisory Commission to paint fairly kind of standard scenes of the Women's Royal Naval Service going about their business. And then she, towards the end of the war, she joined the Red Cross, and she was one of the first people to enter Belsen in April 1945. And the scenes that faced her when she went into the camp, I think, must have stuck with her very vividly in her mind. The painting that she did is called Belsen 1945, of sprawling emaciated bodies just left in piles beneath the trees. It's a very shocking, very harrowing one, and one which I think
kind of conveys the sense of bitterness that must have faced her and others who spent time with the victims and sadly the dead in those first weeks after the camp was liberated.
Far away from the vivid brutality of 1940s Europe, in London 2003, Emily Young was given the chance to create a generic image for the Imperial War Museum's Women at War exhibition. She had to portray a mythical warrior, the Greek goddess Athene, as honestly as possible, devoid of fanciful additional propaganda.
I was asked to do a piece for the Imperial War Museum's Women in War exhibition, and along the lines of a woman warrior, and who came to mind immediately was Athene. She was a great warrior. She's almost always seen with her helmet on, because she's out there doing battle. At the same time, she was the goddess of justice. She would make the rules. She established Athenian justice system, which we still use today. So she's a good example of a woman warrior.
The myth of Athene is all about her warrior attributes. She's supposed to have sprung fully armed from the forehead of her father Zeus, ruler of the gods. It was Athene he trusted with the keys to his thunderbolts, and she rescued Heracles, Perseus, and Odysseus when they were in danger. For her sculpture, Emily Young tried to focus on the essential Athene, producing a simple but distinctive work of art.
She's going to be in a rather dark place, set back in a recess, and so you're coming through darkness and you just see her sort of glowing a bit in this recess. And she's meant to look like something you're not quite sure what you're looking at. It could be very, very old. And I like that sense that, in fact, women in war is a very, very, very old subject. It's been going on since the dawn of mankind. I mean, and you know, before.
Women have been at war for centuries in various roles. Ironically, it has often been war itself that has heightened their expectations and made careers previously dominated by males more accessible. This was true when the Second World War ended in 1945. Society was changing fast, with more and more women entering both medicine and espionage. At the same time, dramatic changes in both fields were taking place, but it was often technology that was spearheading progress as much as social pressure. In the USA, the Women in Military Service Memorial in Washington commemorates the exploits of women in the first major post-war conflicts in Korea and Vietnam.
Satellite controlled by the Soviet Union as a result of the Second World War. North Korea, an armed camp.
The only women who were sent into the battlefield in Korea were nurses. These were Army nurses, Navy nurses, and nurses of the American Air Force. We believe that approximately 1,000 women served as nurses during the Korean War in what we refer to as MASH units. And the most important thing about the MASH units during the Korean War was that they were highly mobile. You have to remember, this was an exceptionally mobile war. The front lines changed dramatically, constantly, in a way that the military couldn't predict. And so in many cases, these MASH nurses ended up far closer to the front lines than they had anticipated, or their military commanders had anticipated, or the American public had any thought that they were that close.
But the fluid nature of the conflict was not replicated in the Vietnam War, where field hospitals were often in the same place for long periods.
For nurses who were assigned to what we call field hospitals or station hospitals in Vietnam, there was a constant danger of capture by North Vietnamese guerrillas. And of course, there was the danger, physical danger, of being shot or having your hospital bombed.
We were issued flak jackets and helmets, and every time there was something overhead, of course, we had to don our flak jackets and helmet and spent the time underneath our beds. We tended to have a good time then, and we talked to each other as we were trying not to be frightened. Again, nothing came close to the facility, although those were rather trying times. You just never knew.
During the Vietnam War, huge advances in casualty evacuation techniques meant the wounded could be extracted from the battle and taken to the hospitals far more quickly. In the 21st century, once again, it is organizations operating outside the direct control of government with a humanitarian rather than a political agenda that are leading the way in providing medical services in the conflicts across the globe. Today, many women are routinely instrumental in both the medical care and the organisation of such services. Jackie Tong is one of the key operational staff of the French-based Médecins Sans Frontières.
Well, I often take on several hats, but when I'm in the field, as we call it, sur le terrain, somewhere like Liberia or Sierra Leone or what have you, I normally take the position of medical coordinator. To do risk analysis for what sort of emergencies might we encounter. If it's in an unstable zone, it might turn hot. And to do emergency preparation for that.
If the role of women in war has changed, the scarcely believable cruelty of man to man has not.
The Hutu extremists initiated the genocide. There was reprisals all over the place. Oh, I had one day where I never wanted to see another Hutu again. And it was after one of our patients got stoned to death by 50 other patients, men, women and children, accused of being a spy. And I can still see that like a tableau in my head across the volcanic plain, and this man, brains all over the place, still reflex breathing, and this gang of people laughing. But then you have to tell yourself, okay, these people are incredibly psychologically damaged by the whole experience. It was a brutal, brutal genocide, and you just have to like shake it down and keep working, and then something will come along that will make it all worthwhile. I've had a few moments, like, am I going to get out of this? We had an assassination attempt in Somalia, missed one of us by 30 centimetres. But sometimes you feel intimidated by the most ridiculous things, and again, it was at a checkpoint. I was illegally in a country, crossing through, you know, without borders, and I had a bunch of Serbs in uniform, and these guys are scary. And I was like, yep, I know I'm wrong, and I really don't want to end up in jail as a spy in Belgrade. And it was just one of those moments that you just suddenly realise the vulnerability. It's fraught with its dangers, but then just so is walking out onto the street. And we do take care.
Another woman who has seen the indiscriminate brutality of modern war and wanted to do something about it, whatever the danger, is Jenny Matthews, a freelance photographer. She involves herself in all aspects of conflict, from covering the marches against the war to the wars themselves. Why does she risk her life, and what does she hope to achieve?
I want my photos to inform, to move people. I had an exhibition recently in London, and it was very moving for me how much time people spent looking and reading. We live in a society where we assume that people don't read anymore. Of course, it's very easy to not be aware of what's going on, but there are different ways of getting to audiences. I've had amazing experiences in Afghanistan. I first went there when the Russians were there in the late 80s, and I've been back, I think, 4 times since, before the Taliban, during the Taliban, and afterwards. And always the sort of warmth of women and the desire to communicate, really. And I think we're all human. We are, you know, it's what makes us human is sharing experiences and, yeah, communication.
Jenny attends anti-war marches and takes shots of the demonstrators. The faces of the various anti-war groupings, she says, are familiar to her. Because she works mainly for herself as an artist, rather than as a hired freelance photographer, and often finds the buyers once she's back home, she is able to choose her subjects and often revisit them.
I've just been to Iraq, and I was doing a story for BBC magazine on a woman I'd first met in 1999, and we were looking for Bader. And again, that was brilliant to see her and to see the war through her eyes and to listen to her stories, and then to walk around Baghdad and for Bader to tell us what had been happening to her in the last few years. Again, with Sierra Leone, there's one woman, Fina, who was just such a fantastic person. She'd been chopped, as she puts it, which meant one of her arms was chopped off by rebel children. And she's such a strong character who was determined that she was going to learn to use her prosthetic arm, and that she was going to, again, her daughter was also chopped, and that she was going to make a future for her child.
Jenny Matthews carries on the tradition of such photographers as Lee Miller. Both are chroniclers of man's cruelty to man and woman. She has also seen many women who, from necessity and belief, have taken up arms.
For some, you know, being a fighter is a great liberation, if you like. It's girls being able to do what boys normally do. That a lot of the young fighters I've met in Central America, in Africa, it's power. It's all the reasons why men are interested in fighting as well, and strutting around with guns, I suppose.
Journalism and nursing have put 21st century women firmly in the front line. Meanwhile, the technological advances made in espionage have altered and expanded the role of women in intelligence gathering. Spy satellites have long since removed the need for so many agents on the ground. Today's spy is more likely to be found behind a desk than hiding out in a Russian wood.
If you were to look at a room full of Central Intelligence Agency area experts, those who really provide the briefing reports for the president to look at every morning, you're going to see 40%, half of them being women. They have to know a lot of history, they have to know languages, they have to be prepared to analyze tremendous amounts of data. And that takes a certain kind of skill that women are certainly capable of earning, of achieving.
The history of women as spies and wartime nurses remains littered with popular myths. The exotic Mata Hari, the martyr Edith Cavell. What is indisputable is that they all risked their lives for their beliefs. Enemies come and enemies go, But women spies and medics retain a prominent position in modern warfare. And without them, the world might be a very different and even more alarming place.